بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم. سورة ياسين lesson 40 and we start with verse number 31. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. ألم يروا كم أهلكنا قبلهم من القرون أنهم إليهم لا يرجعون. Verse 31. Literally, أولم يروا, have they not seen, يرى, and ra'a means to see. Have they not seen ahlakna, how we have destroyed nations and people, qablahum, before them, min al-qurun, from amongst the qurun, generations upon generations, annahum ilayhim la yarji'un, and that there is no doubt that these people are going to return to us. Context again, if we go to verse 30, the people of Antakya of Turkey, 600 years before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came, these people were destroyed because they rejected messengers sent by Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam. As he was raised up to the heavens, he dispatched two messengers to this town in Turkey, Antakya, and these people just killed them and massacred them and rejected them. They actually crucified one of the most sincerest members of the community, as we mentioned, Habib Najjar. So the context is 600 years before the last Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was at the point of raising up Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, where he sent some messengers to this town in Turkey. They rejected the messengers, they killed people just as they wished. And Allah Ta'ala then sent Jibreel alayhi salam to the gates of the city. In kanat illa sayhatan wahida. And he gave one loud sayha, screech, and they were destroyed. We then mentioned the Battle of Badr, which was the only battle in history where Allah Ta'ala sent angels and envoys to assist the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and they fought valiantly and they destroyed the mushrikeen in Makkah. Here we see that one angel was sent just to give a screech and basically topple this town, to show that it wasn't necessary for Allah Ta'ala to send an army, and to show the insignificance because of their attitudes and their arrogance. And this message is being conveyed, this is very important, to the mushrikeen of Makkah 1400 plus years ago, because their attitudes were similar to these people in Turkey. So they've been taken back. So we're at the point now where these people have been destroyed. And we ended off with the word, with the verse, Ya hasratan ala al-ibad. What regret has befallen these people? They are in utter regret in that posthumous state in the next life, because they have recognized and realized that they rejected genuine people who sought no wealth, but just told them that your Lord, who created this entire created order from heaven to earth, if you look around, it's the design of a masterful, crafting, beautiful and majestic Lord, who must be unique and must have the attributes of divinity, because the sun cannot just orbit like it is doing out of its own, nor can the moon be that lamp on its own, nor can the grass just grow, and all this beauty and the insects and the food and things we eat and our brains working and our communication with people, it can't just be happening. And there is no way stones and idols could have created this. So this is the message being brought to these people in Makkah, because as we have said, they have shackled themselves with these aghlal, on the iron collars on their necks, indicating, giving us an image that their heads are up in arrogance and they refuse to bow down in humility and recognize that they can be guided by another human being. Right, so we are at verse number 31. And we said, أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْ كَمْ أَهْلَكْنَا قَبْلَهُمْ مِنَ الْقُرُونَ. Have they not seen how many generations before them have been destroyed, and that they will return to us? أَنَّهُمْ إِلَيْهِمْ لَا يَرْجِعُونَ. They will return to us. So these people, they died upon heedlessness. They died upon a hijab, as the Ahli Sufiya say. Ibn Ajiba in particular in his tafsir says, they died upon a hijab, spiritual exclusion. Because nation upon nation in the past received a messenger firsthand, and they rejected their messengers. They scorned and mocked and insulted them. And they spent their lives trying to kill these messengers. So why? So that they could do as they please and live as kings on this earthly plane. So when you find yourself, the ulama say, reading these verses of past nations destroyed who received first-hand messengers, rejected these messengers, when you reflect upon that and you read these verses, then your attitude should be one of shukr, gratitude in your heart, firstly to Allah Ta'ala, who has placed in your heart faith and has not made you of those who rejected faith by not even seeing the messengers, while they rejected when they saw the messengers. But gratitude for having faith whilst not yet even having set eyes on those messengers. That's how we benefit from these ayat. Use them to increase in love and gratitude before our Creator, because faith is not something you choose to have. It is a gift. It is a seed planted in the heart and can be removed at any time. So when we read these verses, we should increase in shukr, gratitude for what we have with respects to faith. So we are directed here to look at any huge kingdom in the past. None of them are here today. They are all gone. So look back and reflect, in other words. Allah Ta'ala says in the next verse, in kullu lamma jami'u ladayna muhdarun, verse 31. And each and every one will be brought forth to us. Jami'an, all of them, ladayna, to us. Muhdarun, they'll be in our hadrah, in our presence. Again, Ibn Ajibah in his tafsir, he says, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, the biggest loss that these people experience in that life to come is that they are barred from the nur of Allah Ta'ala, from His majestic light and His grace and His mercy. And they'll be resurrected blind, not literally blind, but barred because of their attitude and their rejection in this world, their lack of humility and their compound ignorance and arrogance. Because they refused to accompany those who were gifted and who were blessed with the ability to remove that veil from their eyes and their hearts. They did not allow themselves to humble their hearts before those who were gifted with the gift of removing that veil and opening the eye of their heart to the vision of Allah Ta'ala. And that is the role of the prophets and the awliya and the saliheen. You stick with them because they open the eye of the heart, and that means they make Allah more important to us than this material world. They place Allah first. They remove the dunya from the heart and they replace Allah in that heart. And these are specialized. The awliya are chosen. Okay, a mere glance at them, a mere sitting with them, it's beyond just normal reading of books. It is in some way miraculous, and therefore they are people of karamat. So they remove the veil and they open the door for them, the door to Allah's rahmah. And they are the exemplars, the sheikhs, the ulama, not just anybody, but the true inheritors of the prophetic way, of spiritual guidance. And they exist in every age. We should go out and seek these qualified scholars and sit by them. So this means that this verse is saying that if each and every one of them, these past nations, they will be gathered, jami'an ladayna muhdarun, in our presence, for what? For something called the hisab, at a place of gathering called the mahshar. So as you can hear, we have things to discuss. We need to discuss ideas regarding the hisab, the mahshar, because this Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is talking to a people about something they completely denied, and that is life after death, the resurrection. And this is the heart of Yasin. It's not about fiqh and about my rights and your rights and divorce and marriage and buying and selling. It is about the spiritual life, the reality that is to come after death, true life. It's about that, and therefore Surah Yasin is the qalb, the heart of the Quran. So in our next session, when we discuss verse 32, wa in kullu lamma jami'un ladayna muhdaroon, that all of you will be gathered before us, them and us, we are going to look at some technical terms to grant us a firm grounding on the meanings and the definitions of the ba'ath, the hashr, how we will be herded, the hisab, the being held to account, and look at some classical texts to give us these definitions, because we can find a definition in any book we want, but to get these classic definitions, as the theologians put it, gives you a firmer grounding regarding how to traverse the subject of theology. So we're going to enter the sphere of theology of Tawheed, and in our next session we'll define each of these words. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.